Good evening. You're watching Left, Right and Center. I'm Natasha Jog. Now, it's a politically charged atmosphere in Gujarat as the final countdown begins to those very key elections in the state. But has it just become bitterly, bitterly polarized? The Archbishop of Gandhinagar has issued a letter warning Christians about what he says is the rise of nationalist forces in the country. The BJP has hit out strongly, one leader even asking for his arrest. The Congress too has disassociated itself from the letter. Now, in his appeal, the Archbishop writes, the dates of the Gujarat State Assembly have been declared. The results of this election are significant and it will have its repercussion and reverberation throughout our beloved nation. It will influence the future course of our country. We are aware that the secular and democratic fabric of our country is at stake. Human rights are being violated, constitutional rights are being trampled. Not a single day goes by, he says, without an attack on our churches, church personnel, faithful or institutions. There is a growing sense of insecurity among the minorities, the OBCs, the backward caste and the poor. Nationalist forces, again, the letter says, are on the verge of taking over the country. The election results of the Gujarat State Assembly can make a difference. And that really is our big focus of this evening. Let me introduce my panelists to you right away. Joining me in the Delhi studio, Rakesh Sinha of the RSS, Javed Ansari, senior journalist from Mumbai. I'm joined by Shaina NC of the BJP and Priyanka Chaturvedi of the Congress. Shaina, let me just start by asking you. Now, you know, we heard the letter, we've also sort of been tracking the storm around it. Now, among the things that the Archbishop talks about is not a single day goes by without an attack on churches, church personnel, faithful, or institutions. Of course, there is still a debate and not a day goes by. What are the records? What is he basing this on? But there seems to be a sense of fear there. Is that something that the state government should be looking at closely?
Well, let me please say that, you know, I have traveled the state of Gujarat extensively during this election campaign, and I'm not just talking about rural pockets, but also urban cities. And I want to say, Natasha, that, you know, you speak to the tribals, the poorest of poor, you speak to the Adivasis, you speak to the minorities across the board, and they will tell you that this is the one government that in 22 years has truly shown how to include everyone into the mainstream through policies which don't segregate or have people on the verge and isolated. Mm. Now, when I heard all that he has written, and I have read it extensively, he says that, now Gujarat and the rest of the country awaits Modi's response when he addresses his nation. His first election rally in the state in the next few days, and as if to suggest that he is becoming a kind of proponent or rather proposing that the Congress is an option. Well, that can be his own personal philosophy, and I don't think that we need to come in on that. But his facts are wrong, because there are no 600 incidents that have come to light or which have been brought into the fore. The cases where there has been strong conviction has been where there is a where somebody has violated the law, and not based on this perception. And please do understand that the BJP believes in justice to all and appeasement to none. And probably this could
I want
be
to come back to that point,
because he is not being appeased.
Okay, I want to come back
and
to that point.
Know, for 60
I will come
years,
back
we
to
have
that
only
point
in a country that you've had
okay, you know, whole politics, voting, and religion, and the potent combination that we have. Before I take this to Priyanka Chaturvedi, I know that you want to come in. Before I take this to Priyanka Chaturvedi, Javed Ansari, come in here at this point. Has this really polarized the election than what we've sort of seen in the last couple of weeks and months? Is there a heightened pitch now?
Well, the fear is that that instances like these, incidents like this, will be used to polarize. As a matter of principle, community leaders, religious leaders need to stay out of politics. Certainly, they should not be asking for votes in favor or against based on religious affiliations. Like any other citizen, like you and me, he too has a right to ask for votes, but not in the name of religion. This is my view. This pertains not just to the Archbishop, but to clergy across, cutting across religious affiliations. And therefore, I'm afraid even if he did not mean it, this will be used, and this will be subject to a lot of interpretations and misinterpretations, and this will just add to the kind of thing that you were saying, that, you know, so far mercifully Gujarat elections have been free from this kind of polarization.
Exactly.
We don't know what will happen henceforth.
Right. And Priyanka Chaturvedi, that really is the worry, that are we sort of going down that dangerous polarized slope now in Gujarat? The point that Javed Ansari is making, so far we've sort of stayed away from this. I mean, we've seen a lot of talk in Gujarat. It's been very heated, very angry in part, but staying away from this kind of polarization. We've heard what the Congress has said. No mention of the Congress and BJP in that letter. But of course, you know, it's quite apparent who the references are to. And, you know, for all those who are saying that this is clearly, you know, a move, you know, whether they're trying, he's trying to say that don't vote the BJP, choose the Congress instead. And, you know, it's wondering what the political motive is behind this. How would you respond?
So a couple of things. The point number one, that Congress has always believed that religion has to be kept out of politics and political choices and political parties. Point number two, we haven't sought any votes coming from any religion whatsoever. We have been concentrating, our entire campaign has been concentrating on the development issues that Gujarat faces. Thirdly, I would want to understand, how does a less than 2% population of Gujarat talk about polarizing the entire state of Gujarat and the community and the voting pattern of Gujarat? Christian religion in
0.52% of the
Gujarat
electorate
is less than 2%.
Right.
Practiced across the country is less than 3%. Mm-hmm. So whatever percentage, I mean, they are a minor percentage. So if they are expressing the views, it's exactly like how Swami Narayan Temple's head priest chooses to vote for the BJP. We respect his point of view. We respect even the point of view of, I remember having an argument with Shaina NC from the Bharatiya Janata Party when we had a local election in Mumbai, where Jain Muni in Meera Bhandar had categorically said, let's strengthen the hand of the Chief Minister of Maharashtra, Devendra Fadnavis, as well as the Prime Minister, Mr. Modi, and choose to vote for the Bharatiya Janata Party, even in a local election, chosen to select a political party.
Okay.
Here you have someone who has said, let's choose who you want to vote for, but choice depends on you. So I find this extremely ridiculous how less than 2% minority can decide the fate of Gujarat. I think
let's take that to Rakesh Sinha here.
Of the Bharatiya Janata Party.
Let's take that to Rakesh Sinha here.
They make just 0.52%
of the Gujarat electorate are Christians.
To polarizing voters.
Okay, fair enough. This point being then, is there just too much fuss around it?
No, Natasha, there is a number. There is also narrative behind the number. So here narrative is more important than the number. I would like to remind all of the panelists that secularism in Western countries emerged out of the battle between the church and the state. This was a considered view that church and state, the separation of church and state, this is the essence of secularism, whatever we have been taught from the Western secularism. So therefore, this is a complete negation of secular democracy of India. That is a principally we should accept this fact, and all of us accepting. When we start giving instances other things, then we are diluting the issue. Second important thing here is that I am not going to deliberate how much voters are, but the important thing is that the being the Archbishop, what does you mean by Archbishop? Let the viewers know. He's a higher stage of priest in the church hierarchy, and he is directly appointed by Vatican City, by Pope. He was appointed in perhaps June 2015.
So he has a greater responsibility,
a letter came from Vatican, the Pope Francis. The letter was read by another priest that he has been appointed. So he's a direct.
So you're saying, given his stature, and responsibility,
because he's a direct appointee of Vatican. No, Brenga, let me complete. I have my own point. Because he's a directly appointed by Vatican, so his views can't be considered a merely a domestic church view.
Okay.
He is taking a Vatican view, and you know, just last point. During the Delhi Assembly election, there was a hue and cry that churches are being attacked. Although there was a cases of burglary, there was some disputes. And later on, we couldn't find a single case organized violence by any group. But that
but
time,
did seem but to be that a time, due, and there was a spot in attack due to this human cry,
this news came into New York Times, and all over the world, it has been propagated that in India, the Christian minorities are under serious threat. Mm-hmm. That's why I disagree with the Congress, because I know the Congress sympathy, Sonia Gandhi's sympathy to Vatican and the Catholics.
There we go again. And isn't that also dangerous in a sense?
This is the point I was making, that they continue to bracket her on the basis of her identity, on the basis of where she began from. Mm-hmm. It's extremely unfortunate. They have seen this in 2004, mm-hmm. when the people of the country voted and believed that Mrs. Sonia Gandhi and the Congress Party, because she was the president of the Congress Party, she could lead the country and take it forward into a development phase that the country was looking forward to. What is unfortunate is when you reduce them to their identity, their religious identity. It's extremely, like I said, 2% of the population, less than 2% of the population cannot decide on which way the entire Gujarat polls will go in favor.
But they have lit a fire because they don't have answers as far as their development model is concerned.
They will reduce it to identity. They will reduce it to religious
conclusions.
And what Mr. Zakir Sinha has
he's opposed to the nationalist forces. There are reasons behind that. There is a logic. Logic is that 22 years of BJP rule in Gujarat, that is almost...
Let me be very clear. Who are the nationalist forces?
I don't know.
I'm not debating the nationalist forces.
That
your development model is a flawed model.
I'm sorry, but I just have to get another panelist in, Priyanka. Let's just go to Father Shankar. Thank you for sparing the time to speak to us. Just one quick question. The point that Rakesh Sinha makes over here is that this is very, very irresponsible a comment to make. Would you agree, sir?
No, I would totally disagree, because it is an appeal for prayer, and he has written to all the bishops and the cardinals. He has not appealed to people. Mm. So is it an appeal for a prayer? Is it a crime in this country? That I don't understand. And the issues that he has raised, that are the hard truths there. They are bitter truths. We have to swallow it. They are bitter pills you have to swallow. You cannot simply deny that. The fact that people are being tortured, people are being persecuted, even children are being arrested and put behind bars just because they were traveling to Bombay. All these things are we going to deny? Mm. So when
but it's not
express
just,
our,
it's not coming back to your first fears, point. It's not an innocent call for prayer either. I mean, there is reference to nationalistic forces.
He had clarified today, saying that those people who with narrow-mindedness, in the name of religion, in the name of cow protection, the name of nationalism, patriotism, they are able to attack someone, they can enter somebody's house and then check what they are eating, they can enter into trains, they can check, examine what they are carrying. These are the things which are the real threats to the country. That's what he has been saying that. And he has said he writes letters every month. Every month he writes on different issues.
But the timing is, of course, very important. The state is voting. Okay, thank you, sir. Shaina, would you like to respond to that?
I just want to make two fundamental points. I mean, yes, everyone's entitled to their opinion. He can say that it's not an appeal, but it's clearly an appeal to vote for whichever party they want to espouse for. But this UP election showed you one thing, Natasha, that people have not voted on the basis of caste, community, religious background, belief, etc. People have voted only for development, and that development is seen at the grassroots, whether it's manufacturing output, whether it's industrial output, it's the best ports in the country are in Gujarat, the fact that you know, farmers pay no duty on electricity, pregnant women get subsidies and from the government up to 6 months, all of these are game changers when it comes to women, farmers, Adivasis, and the infrastructure units.
Well, game changes and also highly debatable.
I have seen 22 years. If you're the number one, if you're the number one state in the country, people are not going to fall into the trap of some religious leader who has an agenda.
Okay.